glad you're here. The two songs that I picked, I don't remember how to use this. The two songs that I picked today have to do with our theme. Tempted like Jesus. This one right here is relatable. The song was, "Who am I?" You know, a lot of times we ask that. Sometimes life affects us. Who am I? That's why we picked that song. And same with millions upon millions of people this weekend are going to be thinking about who they are, what their purpose, and how Jesus fits in. And that's why we sang the second song, "Lead Me to the Cross," because this is where we question ourselves. This is where we go. This is where we're. And so that's why we're going to be happy. This is why our theme, which I think is so appropriate, tempted like Jesus. Were we really tempted like Jesus? Was he really like us? Let us pray. Our dearest Heavenly Father, we come before you, the King of the universe. We're going to be talking about your son, Jesus, and what it was like for him down here, like us. And that is such an amazing concept. We pray for each one of us in what we're going through in life, with the people that we love, the things that are going on, wherever we are, conflicts and situations and hardships and challenges. Dear Lord, may you come and bless us at this time in our mind, our spirit, and our soul. Amen.
Amen.
Tempted like Jesus. Well, you know, some of us, we might think, really, was he really tempted? He was God. How could he be tempted like us? How can we be tempted like him? Well, that's what our story is going to be unfolding today. How to resist temptation. And this is the biggest weekend for us to even focus on it, because it's where the rubber meets the road a lot of times. It's where we think, you know, gosh, temptation is everywhere. How do I even resist it? But sometimes we're like this. We're like a mouse with a helmet looking at the mouse trap and thinking, how are we going to get around that with our temptations? And I'm one like that too. I think, okay, can I eat this pizza without getting a migraine? Can I do this and not care? Can I function this way? Can I, you know, and I'm like that mouse. And I thought, this is perfect, because sometimes that's what temptation's like. We know what it's like. We see it. It's right in front of our face. And sometimes we disregard it. Why? Because free cheese is always available in mousetraps. Temptation is always going to be around us, no matter what it looks like. Temptation is always around. And we know what it is for us, and it's not the same for everybody. And temptation isn't just what we see as a major thing. It's the little things sometimes that add up to a big temptation. And only you know what that looks like. I know what that looks like. It's overcoming the temptation. So we're looking at Jesus this weekend and I was asking Kent, you know, there's a lot of churches, they do like Maundy Thursday. I don't even know what that means. And then there's Good Friday. And then there's Jesus was in the tomb on Sabbath Saturday, and then Sunday is when the world looks on the resurrection. And so what was going on with him that we can relate to? And see, if we can't relate to anything, because our vision of Jesus is he's God, he can do anything, I can't even relate. I'm going to share with you the story. The story is what is going to help us through to make this scripture, and I gave each of you, who didn't I give? It's going to make this scripture come alive. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. God's faithful, not grit and bear, grit and bear. Hold on, like that little cat on the poster, you know, that's holding on like this. Hang on! Because we can't without God. It just doesn't work. And so, but when you are tempted, who will also provide a way out? Who? God. So that you can endure it. If we're not enduring it, if we're like that, if we're, it's because God's not in there. And we're going to see this story of why Jesus, why we can relate to him and he can relate to us. Because the story starts here. Oh, I'm so sorry it's so dark here. It was lighter on my computer. This is what it was actually kind of more like. They were like, this is the disciples. They got together on a Thursday evening for Passover. Today, people call it the Last Supper. But it was a Passover meal that they got together, and it's a whole rigmarole that they've done for thousands of years. Not rigmarole. You know, it's a little thing that they... And he is finally saying, okay, this is it. All this time, all of this represented me. And so he's saying, that's what it is. So he's teaching them. 3.5 years later, they were all together, you know, that 3.5 years later of discipleship college, because then they're going to be on their own. Just like if you go to college, then afterwards you're on your own. You don't have teachers. You got to go do your own thing. So he's telling them, this is what's going on. I'm warning you. Do this, do that. This, do this in remembrance of me. And they're like, wow, what? And they still don't get it. But they're a little bit they were getting. And so they're taking the bread and the wine, and he's trying to still teachable moment. Still teachable moment. And they're thinking, oh, this is wonderful. We're with Jesus. This means for him, but I don't really get what he's saying. But this is really nice for us to be with him. This is wonderful. And then he took the bread and gave thanks and break it and gave it unto them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. That's why we're called Bread of Life Church, because this is what gives us life. And he says, do this in memory of me. So he's telling the disciples, he's telling us, do this. Because then you'll remember me, you'll know what I did for you. Wait a minute, we're going back to the picture, because they just finished doing that, having the, and the last thing was Judas dipped with Jesus the bread, because they're dipping and they were, you know, partaking. Wait a minute, Judas was Jesus' friend. Judas was one of the disciples. And Jesus said, go do what you need to do. And Judas went and betrayed him. The others were clueless. They're all, you know, they're just visiting and they don't even know what's going on. And just like sometimes we don't know what's going on. Sometimes we're very much like the disciples. We go along, we listen, until something happens to trigger us to remember what God wants us to remember. So after supper, after the dinner, after the Passover meal, they sang a hymn, and then he said, come on, let's go. I want to pray. This is what sustained him, were these prayers. This connection with the God of the universe. And this is why he's tempted like we are. It was not easy. And I'm going to have 3 pictures up there, and then I'm going to have the scripture of why I have these 3 pictures. And do you see him? He's like praying. Has anybody here prayed like this for anybody ever? I have. And this is why he's so much like us, is because of how 3.5 years of trying to work with people and show what it was like and what, you know, what his ministry was about. And he's there. The biggest temptation he had was, I can't take it. I can't take it. Anybody else ever said that? I know I have. You have too. I'm done. I am done. I can't take it anymore. It's too hard. Whatever I think of the story, just... So this is the story. I mean, I tell you, it just affected me this week. Remembering it. And that's why Jesus said, do this in remembrance of me. Because when we start thinking about him, we remember him and what he went through, it helps us. That temptation is, I can't take it. Matthew 26:36-46. Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to them, sit here while I go over there and pray. He took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him, and they began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, my soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. I have felt like this sometimes. I feel like I'm all alone in my feelings. So he's asking his disciples, we ask our friends sometimes to support us, we ask our family members to support us, and sometimes they're not there. They're not there. And for Jesus, they weren't there. Stay here and keep watch with me. Going a little farther, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, my Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me. You might have heard that before, but really, you know what he's saying? I don't want to do this. I don't want to do this. It's too hard. Please, please. And see, this is where we see humanity. This is where his prayer time was of importance, was essential, because really, he knew he was God, but he was not going to wear the God, or what was the point? If he could wear his Godship, then what kind of example would he be for us? He wouldn't. He couldn't be an example for us. We could not relate to him. He had the human card on. He had the human form. And that's why it says he was tempted like we were. To give up. And he could have said, you know what? These humans are not worth it. Just take me back. These humans, it's too hard. I mean, look, it's too hard. Yet, not as I will, but as you will. Then he returned his disciples and found them sleeping. Couldn't you men keep watch with me for 1 hour? He asked Peter. Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. Watch and pray. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. He knew that firsthand because of what he was going through. Understanding, we go through the same thing. We will go through the same thing. He's trying to warn us. He's trying to warn Peter. The flesh is weak. Spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. He went away the second time and prayed, my Father, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it, may your will be done. He's still wanting it. He's trying to negotiate here. He's trying to see. He's voicing his feelings. It's okay. It's okay to go to God with that. He's our example. It's okay. We can't always pretend we're strong. We cannot. Sometimes we're naturally strong. Some of us have a naturally strong personality. But man, when we're weak, we're down. We're down for the count sometimes. And then he puts in our minds and he helps us remember these stories and the word of God that strengthen us, that strengthen him. When he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. That's how temptation is. Sometimes there's nobody there. It's tempting to give up. It's tempting to not follow. It's tempting to say, can't take it. I mean, these are his closest people, and they weren't even there to support him. His closest people. Sometimes, you know, you feel like you're all alone. Nobody understands. So he left them and went away once more and prayed the third time. Okay, would we call him a nag? But you know what? God didn't see him as a nag. He said, oh, my son is struggling. Just like my daughter's struggling, just like we are struggling, just like you are struggling. Saying the same thing. Then he returned to the disciples and said to them, are you still sleeping and resting? See, that third time is when he understood that God was going to be by his side no matter what the future held. Things were black now. Because he was in human form, he knew all the promises. He knew what the scripture said. He knew what was ahead of him because it had been prophesied, because God had told him. But it still wasn't easy, just like what if we know. God said, you know, stay with me. The scriptures say this. He'll be with us no matter what till the end of time. But is it still easy to go through the junk we go through? Dealing with the people we have to deal with if they're not nice? It's not easy. And that's why this story is in here, to show the humanist. Because if you know what, if he had it all together, that story wouldn't be in there. He wouldn't have prayed, take it from me. It wouldn't have shown the struggle that we need to see because of our humanness and his humanness. And so he finally settled in his heart. Like some of us have to, that God's going to see us through this. No matter what we see, no matter who's beside us, no matter what's going to go on, the next step, the next day, the next... Jesus had an idea, but he didn't know exactly. Are you still sleeping and resting? Look, the hour has come, and the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer. Okay, we knew this was going to happen. I tried to warn you. And you know what? He had warned Peter. He had warned Peter. Still failed him at the last minute. And so as a song, as we sing this song, now, if you want to sing along, it's English and Spanish, but this is a song about the way of suffering that we go through. Jesus did. He knew, but he did not call on his God card, his God powers, so that he could relate to us and we could relate to him. The Via Dolorosa, many of you might have heard it. Amen. He knew what he had to do, and he didn't, I'm sure he didn't realize how hard it was going to be before, until it started happening. And sometimes that's how our trials are. That's how our temptations are. We don't know how hard it is until we're going through it. We know we're going to have problems. We know there's going to be hardships. There's a picture here of Jesus, but you know what? This is nothing compared to what they did to him. What sin did to him. And so as you review this, God found a way for Jesus to get through this. He spoke to his heart, he spoke to his mind to hang in there the same way he does for us. Plus, he gave him some encouraging things to focus on while he was going through this, like he wants to do for us. When we're tempted to give up, when we're tempted to just give in, when we're tempted to just throw it all into the toilet. So, God spoke to Jesus' heart. The last words on the cross, and this is how ugly it was. It was very ugly by the time he was there. Forgive others. That's what he said. Forgive them, for they know not what they do. That is so hard to do. But he knew. But God knew Jesus needed to do that because he could harbor. Because he had a human heart, he could harbor the same thing we do for people. Forgive them, for they know not what they do. Encourage them that heaven was going to be real. He told John, number three, care for your parents. He told John, here's your mother now, take care of her. To marry his mother, here's your son. He had a job. He was busy, even on the cross, caring for others. And sometimes what happens, and I do the same thing, when we're tempted to, I can't do it, is I. We're too focused. When we get busy, when we start thinking of others, we step out of it so much sooner, so much more than when we're self-focused. He had a lot to feel sorry for himself for. He had a lot that he could have just, oh, forget that noise. Oh, my goodness, I'm here. You know, he still could have given up. Express your heart to God. He was still. He said, why, God, have you forsaken me? He was talking to God still. Had God forsaken him? No. God knew he had to go through this hard part before he could go through the other part. And so sometimes when we're going through it, we thought, God, I can't see you, I can't feel you, I can't hear you. It's too dark and it's too black. And that's what Jesus was feeling by his expression. Be thirsty for the living water. He said he thirsted. The people were still mean, but he was thirsty. Don't give up. Finish it. And that's what he said at the end. It is finished. His job. What is our job? What is God calling us to do? Sure, it may not be this. We're not going to have to do that. It was already done for us. But sometimes things are just plain hard. It'd be easier to say, I can't. I am in despair like he was. Place your life in God's hand. And that was his very last. Into your hands, I commit my spirit. That was it. And he died. Still not seeing what was going to happen Sunday morning. He died. He knew the plan, but he didn't know how it was all going to be. He was still in human mode. Human frailty. There's a movie out called The Risen. Has anybody heard of that? Oh my goodness. It is like very authentic and realistic about how life was back then. The Romans, what they did with people they crucified and how they, it was horrendous. As far as, I think it was PG-13. For me, that's too much. I can't watch art. Too graphic, too much. But this gives you a real glimpse of what Jesus would have gone through. The Passion of the Christ, similar, but you didn't get the view of, this is the Roman soldier's view. And the tomb, and what happened. They laid him. Afterwards, you know, this experience, horrendous. And the tomb. We don't know if this really was it. But Jesus, according to Scripture, was not in heaven. He was in the grave. He was in the tomb, I mean, not the grave. But this is what they called grave. Back then, they didn't bury people because it was too rocky and hard. They had to put them in caves. And they buried a lot of people in caves. And it was very difficult to bury people under the ground. In some places they did. But this is the tomb. And they rolled the stone. And he was there since Friday afternoon after they took him off. Normally, they would have thrown him in a heap with all the other ones that were crucified. They would just take him off. That's all they did. Because they pierced him, you know. But Joseph of Arimathea had claimed him. And then they took him, gave him permission to take him to a tomb. And this is what they did, or he would have been in a heap. But God provided even then. God inspired somebody. So when you're down in the dumps, when you feel like giving up, let God make a way of escape in your mind, make a way of escape with people around you, and he'll send somebody. Remember? In that scripture that you have, he will find somebody to help you, or he'll give you a thought in your mind to find the way of escape out of that temptation. Just like he did and provided here. The next song we're going to be singing is He's Alive. There's just a couple more things to close with, but these are powerful. Because this is the purpose of this whole purpose of life, is what happens next. And so, this is a ballad that somebody sang that just... The true reason for the season. The story that changed lives. He's alive and I'm forgiven. How many of us have been like Peter? How many of us have just denied him? How many of us have said, I can't anymore? At one time or another in our Christian walk, heaven's gates are open wide. But Peter understood afterwards. We can understand afterwards the purpose, the vision, Jesus' life, how he was able to do it and how he can help us do it. Our temptation today is don't believe it. It doesn't work. It's too hard. Thomas, one of the disciples, oopsie. Thomas, one of the disciples said, I'm not going to believe he rose. Until I see his hands and see his side, I'm not going to believe it. How many people we know like that? They don't believe. I have family members don't believe. Do you know how hard that is for me? To understand? To share this? They don't believe. Family, friends, close ones. The road to Emmaus. There's a story about how two of the disciples were going, and then all of a sudden this guy appears, and he's trying to tell them how Jesus, why it was the scriptures, and they're like, oh, I don't get it. And then finally, their mind was opened up. That's how this can be for us. And Jesus understood Thomas, and he understood the guys in the road to Emmaus. Still helped them through the times, the rough times of unbelief. How can you work towards overcoming temptation? I have that as your handout. Relationships, knowledge, decisiveness. That's what Jesus had every step of the way. Relationship with his God. He had it for a little bit with his friends. Knowledge that things were going to get rough, but the knowledge that God was not going to leave him. Decisiveness, that he needed to do this for us. That he needed to do this, the cause, the same one that he gives us. And community. People around us, church, family, love. All the different things that go hand in hand. And so the ultimate gift is, for by grace are ye saved through faith. The belief. That is, one guy came to Jesus and said, help my unbelief. If we don't believe something, help God our unbelief. Because that's where faith comes in. And that's revelation, mustering enough, whatever. It's the gift of God, that gift that we're focusing on this weekend, of Jesus' life, his death, and what he wants to do. So at this time, those of you that would like to participate, because he said, take this bread, this is me, this is about me, this is what I did, so that you can remember me, what I did. So Scott's going to, actually I can.
Oh. Okay.
Oh, I was going to play this song. Jesus' name, we pray in this.